forced marriage and pardons for convictions of certain abolished offences.
Gerda Margaret, thank you. And I call the Minister for Justice.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. I beg to move that this Assembly endorses the principle of the extension to Northern Ireland of a number of provisions within the Policing and Crime Bill by amendments at Lords Committee and Lords Report stage, insofar as they relate to the United Kingdom Maritime Enforcement Powers, United Kingdom Cross-Jurisdictional Arrest Powers, anonymity for victims of forced marriage and pardons for convictions for certain abolished offences. The Policing and Crime Bill was introduced to Westminster on the 10th of February this year and is expected to complete its final stage in December. It is a carryover bill from the previous parliamentary session and contains a wide range of policy proposals which form part of the United Kingdom's Government's manifesto commitment to complete the work on police reform and further improve the efficiency and effectiveness of the police. The wider provisions will also lead to closer collaboration with other emergency services, enhance the democratic accountability of the police and fire and rescue services. They will help increase public confidence in policing, strengthen the protection for suspects under investigation by or who come into contact with the police. They will ensure that the police and other law enforcement agencies have the powers they need to prevent, detect and investigate crime, and further safeguard children and young people from sexual exploitation. There are a number of specific provisions within the bill that either have a UK cross-jurisdictional dimension or make provisions for matters that I believe would benefit the law in Northern Ireland by way of extension or by separate provisions subject to the legislative consent of this Assembly. The motion is in relation to four separate and distinct policy proposals, all of which relate to devolved matters and fall within the criminal justice sphere. First, there are provisions which deal with maritime enforcement powers for wider criminality at sea. Law enforcement officers in Northern Ireland have maritime enforcement powers under the Modern Slavery Act to deal with the specific offences of human trafficking and of slavery, servitude and forced and compulsory labour. They also have separate powers to tackle the illicit trafficking of controlled drugs. This proposal will extend equivalent maritime enforcement powers for the purposes of preventing, detecting or investigating any offence under the law of Northern Ireland in relation to the United Kingdom or foreign vessel in Northern Ireland waters. The powers to be made available to law enforcement officers would allow them to stop, board, divert and detain a vessel, to search and obtain information, and to arrest suspects and seize property. The introduction of these powers in England, Wales and Scotland and their extension to Northern Ireland via this motion will ensure that police across the United Kingdom and appropriate law enforcement officers have at their disposal the powers they need to deal effectively with broader criminal activity should it arise on board vessels in the retrospective territorial waters. All territorial waters will remain the responsibilities of the respective authorities. While recognising that such circumstances are likely to be infrequent, I also want to ensure reciprocal provisions are made in relation to hot pursuit. And my department will seek to make provision for hot pursuit powers for the PSNI, subject of course to securing the agreement of the Policing Board in relation to accountability and agreeing with the Scottish Government the oversight arrangements for our Police Scotland. Once the necessary arrangements are in place, I will then seek to identify a legislative vehicle to take this forward at the earliest opportunity. The second proposal relates to an important change to the current UK cross-jurisdictional arrest powers. Currently, police officers in their own jurisdictions need a warrant to arrest a person suspected of having committed an offence in another UK jurisdiction. What is proposed is a power for officers to arrest without a warrant someone who is suspected of committing a serious offence in another part of the UK. In effect, this will enable the person to be detained in police custody for a time-bound period pending the arrival of officers from the jurisdiction where the suspect is wanted. The person will then be rearrested and returned for questioning. The detention period will be subject to regular review and the arrested person will be afforded the same rights and entitlements as would be provided in the jurisdiction in which the alleged offence was committed. It is also intended that the power of arrest will be restricted to any offence that may attract a period of imprisonment of 10 years or more, in addition to a list of other specified offences considered serious enough for inclusion. The third element relates to forced marriage. Currently, a victim of forced marriage may be granted anonymity at the discretion of the court, but it is not automatic. This proposal is aimed at providing automatic anonymity to victims of forced marriage, similar to that introduced for victims of female genital mutilation, which was extended to Northern Ireland within the Serious Crime Act 2015 by the use of a legislative consent motion. We know forced marriage is a hidden crime, and this measure will give victims the confidence to come forward so they receive the support they deserve and so perpetrators are brought to justice. The fourth and final policy proposal within the motion relates to pardons for convictions for certain abolished sexual offences. The United Kingdom Government has indicated its support for late amendments to the Policing and Crime Bill to provide in England and Wales statutory pardons for gay and bisexual men who were convicted of certain sexual offences that would not be offences today. In order to qualify for a pardon, the activity must have been consensual and involve a person aged 16 or over, which is the current age of consent. These amendments build on an existing provision in the Protection of Freedoms Act 2012, which introduced a disregard scheme for such offences in England and Wales. A successful application for a disregard results in details of such criminal convictions being deleted from relevant official records. These earlier provisions, however, do not currently extend to Northern Ireland. The latest amendments for England and Wales will mean that anyone who has their conviction or caution disregarded through these provisions will automatically be pardoned for the offence. In addition, the amendments will confer an automatic posthumous pardon for those with convictions or cautions for the same offence. The draft provisions which this motion asks the Assembly to agree will introduce similar arrangements for Northern Ireland. A disregard scheme would be introduced whereby individuals can apply to my department to have their convictions for certain abolished offences disregarded on criminal records, and where this application is successful, an automatic pardon will be conferred, and an automatic pardon will also apply in posthumous cases. I believe that by giving permission for Westminster to pass these provisions for Northern Ireland offers an immediate opportunity for the criminal justice system here to right the wrongs of the past. It would also then allow us to consider additional detailed issues unique to Northern Ireland. In the meantime, we can at least ensure that the criminal law in Northern Ireland offers equality of treatment for gay and bisexual men in Northern Ireland, as it would do in England and Wales. There is one aspect of the provisions which I know has caused some interest and concern, and this is the perceived inequality of offering pardons for convictions for same-sex activity but not for opposite sex behaviour after the age of consent equalised at 17 for all sexual activity. The Justice Committee referred to this issue when my officials gave evidence on the pardon amendments at its meeting on the 10th of November, and the member for North Antrim who will move the amendment to take these provisions out of the motion has also raised concerns over equality. The Department has taken account of its Section 75 duty to have regard to the need to promote equality of opportunity between persons of different sexual orientation. These amendments to the Policing and Crime Bill provide an opportunity in this respect to address the historical wrongs suffered by gay and bisexual men who were criminalised over a long period for something that society regards today as normal sexual activity. I am, however, aware that we have an added dimension here because the parity in the age of consent with the rest of the UK did not happen here until 2009 when it became 16. The criteria for a successful application for a disregard and subsequent pardon in England and Wales are that the activity was consensual and that the other party was aged 16 or over. In England and Wales, the age of 16 has been the age of consent in respect of sexual activity with girls since the 19th century. However, up until 1967, all sexual activity between men of any age was criminalised, and it was not until 2000 that the age of consent for sexual activity between men was equalised at 16. After that, there was no longer any discrimination against same-sex activity. In Northern Ireland, the age of consent was set in 1950 at 17 for heterosexual activity. However, all sexual activity between men was criminalised up to 1982. Again, it was 2000 before the age of consent was equalised for both genders, but here the age was set at 17. After that, it is hard to see any further discrimination between either gender, and therefore my view is that there is no obvious requirements to offer disregards and pardons for offences where the other party was 16, at this age of consent applied to all sexual activity of whatever gender. A specific issue for Northern Ireland arises because our age of consent changed again in 2009 for both genders, and it is now, as in the rest of the United Kingdom, 16. And I acknowledge that this means that consensual sexual activity before 2009, where the other party was 16, is no longer considered to be criminal behaviour. However, this is the same for sex with either a boy or girl of that age. It is my opinion that the policy basis for the disregard arrangements and the proposed pardons is not just to address convictions for offences purely on the basis that the activity is no longer considered to be lawful, although that of course is part of it, but rather to right the fundamental wrongs brought about by a criminal law which allowed and perpetrated discrimination and social injustice for a long period against a specific group of people. These arrangements are not and should not be only about the fact that these offences have been criminalised, and I do not think that there would be consensus that simply because decriminalisation occurred there was an injustice to those previously convicted. The reason for such a significant gesture goes much deeper, and we need to acknowledge that. My view at this time is that we can ask Parliament to introduce legislation for us on the same footing as in England and Wales, which for now means disregards and pardons for consensual activity with a person aged 17 and over. I am, however, not ruling anything out at this stage, and I am happy to offer a commitment to look again at the whole issue of consensual sexual offences involving 16-year-olds and to bring that back to the Assembly for consideration. As this situation is unique to Northern Ireland, I do believe that it is only right that we have time to properly consider the policy and to provide an opportunity for this Assembly to make a decision. Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, I commend this LCM to the Assembly.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. In moving this amendment, as is clear from it, I am wholly supportive of the first three measures contained within the legislative consent motion. But totally opposed to the fourth component. And in essence, in addressing this issue, my opposition probably falls under three interrelated headings. First of all, there is the process deployed to get us to the point that we're at. Secondly, there's the principle involved in what we've been asked to do. And thirdly, there's the act of discrimination involved in what we're being asked to do. So as I work my way through those, I begin with the process. I think the House needs to come to terms with the novelty of what we are doing today. Never, I say never, in the history of this jurisdiction has legislation been used to give retrospective pardons. I say that on the strength of an answer from the Minister when I asked her to detail on how many occasions a pardon in legislation in Northern Ireland had been provided for in respect of obsolete criminal offences. And the answer was very clear. I am not aware of any statutory provision in modern times for a pardon for obsolete criminal offences. So what we're doing today in granting a pardon for obsolete criminal offences is without precedent, making it all the more remarkable that we've arrived at this rushed position without any consultation on this matter. This House and this Executive likes to pretend that it's big on consultation, that it likes to consider what public opinion and stakeholders have to say on an issue. Indeed, if you go to the Northern Ireland Direct website, you will read many platitudes about public consultation. It says it's an important part of the policy-making process. It will say running a consultation is not simply about more open government. It is about making policies more effective by listening and taking on board the views of the public and interested groups. And yet, here we are today with a totally novel proposition to grant pardons for obsolete criminal offences, and there hasn't been one iota of consultation on the matter. And then we compound that by saying, in fact, we're so unconcerned about this issue, we're going to pass over the legislative function to Westminster. We're so disinterested, We're not even going to consider it ourselves. And the legislative consent motion is and always should be a serious matter. It is this House saying to all and sundry, we are passing up on our opportunity to legislate about something and gifting it to Westminster. But when you do that without even consulting on an issue, then it is all the more stark. And when you do it in respect of an anticipated clause in a bill which wasn't even in the bill when it was published, then the thing gets even more ridiculous. And indeed, the process by which we got here, the rush to get here, is very informative indeed, because we have a Standing Order 42A, which says that there is a stipulated, prescribed process for passing and getting to the point of passing a legislative consent motion. And it requires the laying of a legislative consent memorandum. And it requires it to be laid within 10 days of the clause it wants to activate becoming part of the bill. And yet it seems in this case that the relevant clause only became part of the bill on the 9th of November in the House of Lords, and yet the legislative consent memorandum was issued on the 7th of November. Such was the haste and the rush. We couldn't even wait for our own processes on this issue. So there are many reasons in terms of the process. Yes?
And he outlines a number of procedural reasons for him not to be happy with this proposal. If all manner of consultation was followed and all checks and balances was gone through, would the member support it?
No, the member would not. I make no secret of that. But I am legitimately entitled to object to the farce which this process has turned into. But I would have liked a consultation. I would have liked to have heard what Mr. Storey's Caleb Foundation said about this proposal. I'd like to have heard what various church members, the churches that many members belong to, who still preach that homosexuality is a sin, I'd like to have known what those churches thought of this proposal. And the elders of some of those churches sit in this House. I would certainly have liked to have known what in consultation they thought of validating homosexuality by virtue of pardons. But we're not to be, and maybe that's why, we're not to be given that opportunity, because this is something that the powers that be in this House want to rush through. Indeed, this is a proposal that didn't even come to the executive. This proposal was activated by the First and Deputy First Minister signing it off on emergency procedures. And then the executive is told it's been done. So there was not even consultation within the executive about this proposal. And indeed, I know there wasn't even consultation in the DUP about this proposal. The members were simply told, this is it. Suck it up. So not only was there an absence of consultation with the public, with stakeholders, indeed, according to some press, the only stakeholder the minister ever met on this issue was the LGBT community. No one else had the opportunity to bend her ear about this issue. So I make fundamental objection to coming to this House today with a proposition which has been rushed and is attempted to be pushed through this House without due process, never mind an equality impact assessment or anything else. So the process, I suggest, is flawed. But what about the principle? What about this notion that we in 2016 as legislators can rewrite the statute book retrospectively, that we can decide not what the law was in the 1920s, 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, but what it should have been. My goodness, as a House, we've difficulty enough, I think, legislating for 2016. But the arrogance of it, that we are going to now decree what the law should have been 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago. The principle is wrong. It is not for this House, as it never has done in the past, and there's good reason for that. It is not for this House to rewrite history. If something was a criminal offence, it was a criminal offence. And for this House to think that it should impose its moral standards or immoral standards retrospectively is plain wrong. And of course, for some, it's also a matter of rewriting their party history. For the DUP, it's a matter of rewriting their party history of Save Ulster from sodomy. Because what we're involved in here today has all the appearance of some contrived collective act of contrition, whereby, in the words of the minister, we're righting a wrong of the past. It's certainly a matter of what's right and what's wrong, but it's not for this assembly to rewrite the statute book, because that is the effect of this pardon. It is to validate as non-criminal that which was criminal. To wish, pretend, to sweep it away. I will.
I think, like many others, I do see this as a righting of the wrong of the past. Can I ask, does the member think that these acts should still be illegal?
That is not the issue. The issue is whether this House, in 2013, in its arrogance, thinks that it can take upon itself to rewrite the law of 40 years ago. It can't. It shouldn't. The law was the law. Those who chose to break the law, knowing what the law was, if they paid a penalty, that was the law taking its course, whether they were homosexual or heterosexual. And I'll say more about that in a moment. But it is not for this House to impose its standards retrospectively. Because the effect, the inescapable effect of pardoning posthumously and creating a path to pardon for those still alive, the inescapable effect is to validate that which was a crime. To say it should never have been a crime. That is what the minister's saying. But is that what everyone who's going to allow this through today is saying? Yes, on this side of the House, that is probably so. But what about those that we're going to save Ulster from sodomy? Are they now validating sodomy? Are they now saying, let's rewrite that, let's rub that out? Because that's what you're doing. The moment, either by acquiescence or active voting, you assent to a pardon for this obsolete criminal offence. You can twist, you can turn, you can try and run away from it. That's the reality. And indeed, it's been put very specifically by the minister in answer to another question, which I tabled to her. When she said, and she said it again today, It's about addressing historical wrongs suffered by gay and bisexual men who were criminalised over a long period for something that society regards today as normal sexual activity. So listen well. Everyone today who's going to endorse by their silence or their vote this pardon is accepting that homosexuality, which many of their churches teach still is a sin, that buggery is still wrong, that's the teaching many of them have, that nonetheless is a normal sexual activity. And the challenge to this House, to everyone as an individual, with their own conscience, are they prepared, by their inaction or their action today, to embrace and endorse the validation of homosexuality as normal sexual activity? No ducking, there's no diving, that's the question. And that particularly is the question for those who are ruling elders in certain churches that still take that stand. Some would have sat in pews yesterday of churches that still teach that homosexuality is a sin. Are they going to sit on their hands today and validate the view that it's not? As some of them hide in their rooms, running away from this debate today, in a moment, because they don't want to be faced. Well, there'll come a day, and it won't be here, when they will account for all they've said and done. Yes, I'll give one.
Given everything you've said, do you believe that the treatment of Alan Turing, the war hero being chemically castrated, was a suitable punishment for his service to this country?
No, I don't think chemical castration was ever a suitable punishment. But that doesn't mean that the law should not have been as the law was in terms of what was legal and what was illegal. And it's not for us, just as we can't undo that, it's not for us 50, 60 years later to sanctimoniously proclaim from these benches or elsewhere that this is how the law should have been. It's not for us, fellow members, to do that. The law was as it was, and it's not our responsibility. And if it was wrong, it was the responsibility of those who made that law, but not of this House. You see, what this is clearly all about is about a fashionable pandering to a particular interest. That it's now so fashionable to jump on board the LGBT bandwagon that you simply abandon all principles, leave your beliefs outside the door. I remember a debate not so long ago, and members on the DUP benches told us how they could not, would not leave their beliefs outside the door. That's what they're going to do today. Because this, they're not prepared to stand against the fashionable pandering to an interest. And it brings me to my third point. A fashionable pandering which is reeking of active discrimination. Because it is only in respect of homosexual crimes that we are embracing the idea of pardons. There are many heterosexuals who still to this day carry the stain, if you want, of being convicted of a criminal offence, which is no longer a criminal offence. But no one's proffering pardons to them. Yes, as an afterthought, the minister today says, oh yes, we could look at that. Well, let me make my position clear. I don't think it's right to give pardons retrospectively for homosexuals or heterosexuals. The law was the law, whatever it was. And if you chose to break the law, you chose to break the law. So I don't believe in rewriting history. But the discrimination that's involved here is self-evident. Take the young man. In my time professionally, I would have appeared for a number of them. Take the young 17 or 18-year-old who maybe had consensual sexual relations with a 16-year-old girl. He was committing the crime of unlawful carnal knowledge. Many were prosecuted for it. Today, having sexual relations with a 16-year-old girl is not a crime, because the age of consent is now 16. But for decades in this province, it was 17. So why is no one up on their indignant high horse saying, oh, what a shame, what a stain on our collective history, that we must perform this act of collective contrition and give pardons to all the young men convicted of unlawful carnal knowledge when today it wouldn't be a crime? Isn't that the hypocrisy of this situation? That we're prepared to embrace the active discrimination that is wrapped up in this proposal, that we only show interest in, concern for, and act for the homosexual community. But we turn our back, do nothing in our rush to get this through for the heterosexual community. There are parties in this House, the SDLP is one of them, who loudly proclaim their undying devotion to equality. Where's the equality here? It's absent. And yet today, the SDLP will enthusiastically engage in this act of societal redemption. Yes?
I thank the member for giving way. Would he not accept that there is a qualitative difference between the two points he makes? Whereas a homosexual man was attracted to solely homosexual men and therefore was being outlawed effectively from having sex in the way that was natural to him. The example you give where the person had sex with a 16-year-old, their sexual attraction was not solely to 16-year-olds. They weren't discriminated against by the state.
Sorry. They were discriminated against by the fact that the criminal law said the act they were engaging in was unlawful. That's the common denominator. That which the criminal law decreed as unlawful was unlawful in respect of heterosexual offences and unlawful in respect of homosexual offences, and that's the common denominator. But what this really points up is the enthusiasm of this House to turn its back on that gross inequality. I make plain again, I'm not urging in this House that it starts down a road of going through our statute book and offering pardons for every now obsolete offence. My goodness, where would you stop? It used to be an offence to be an incorrigible vagrant. An incorrigible rogue was the criminal offence. And now some might think, good job, it's not an offence. Aye, but that used to be a criminal offence. Across the water in 2000 and recent years, they took 300 old criminal offences off the statute book, but they didn't offer pardons. They didn't take it arrogantly upon themselves to rewrite the law. They said, those offences serve no purpose, let's remove them. Our own Criminal Justice Miscellaneous Provisions Act of 1968 took away in this old House many old criminal offences, but no one ever said that you must pardon those because it really never should have been an offence. So why the difference today? Why are we so overrun and overwhelmed by this fashionable fad that we have to do something for the single community LGBT, we have to cleanse ourselves, seems to be the attitude. But everyone else, tough. That's how the law was. You chose to break it. Tough. That's how it should be for everyone. And this is a totally unnecessary, fruitless exercise, which only exposes the inequality that this House is prepared to embrace, as well as some embracing that which in their past they said was wrong, but apparently today is going to be right. Thank you.
I call Paul Frew, Chair of the Committee.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker. The Minister of Justice has already outlined the purpose of the legislative consent motion, so I don't intend to rehearse everything that has already been said. However, I do want to outline the committee's consideration of the policy areas covered by the motion. Whilst the Justice Committee is of the view that, where possible, legislative change should be taken through this Assembly, on this occasion it agreed that a legislative consent motion would be the most appropriate course of action. First, I want to set out the background to the Committee's consideration of all the proposals submitted to us for possible inclusion in the Policing and Crime Bill. At its meeting on the 16th of June 2016, the Committee considered departmental written briefing papers on three proposed LCMs for the Policing and Crime Bill. The LCMs covered maritime enforcement powers, police powers across UK jurisdictions, and biometric retention in relation to foreign convictions. At the request of the committee, departmental officials attended the meeting on the 15th of September to give evidence on the proposals. On the same day, the committee also considered a written departmental briefing on a fourth proposed legislative consent motion on lifelong anonymity for victims of forced marriage. At the meeting on the 22nd of September, the committee agreed that it was content with the proposals to extend the provisions for lifelong anonymity of victims of forced marriage and police arrest powers across UK jurisdictions to Northern Ireland. It also agreed that it was content with the proposal to extend the biometric retention provisions in relation to foreign convictions in the Policing and Crime Bill to Northern Ireland by way of the LCM. Sinn Féin members of the committee, however, indicated that they were opposed to this proposed legislative consent motion. At the meeting on the 6th of October, the committee reached agreement on the LCM on maritime enforcement powers. The committee agreed that it was content with the proposed legislative consent motion on maritime enforcement powers, subject to a number of conditions. The reasons for the committee's conditional agreement will become clear when I come to talk specifically about the maritime enforcement provisions. On the 27th of October, the Department of Justice laid a legislative consent memorandum for the Policing and Crime Bill, which included a consolidated draft motion covering three out of the four previous considered policy areas. Maritime enforcement powers, not including hot pursuit powers, I may add, UK cross-jurisdictional arrest powers, and anonymity for victims of forced marriage. So we had not four, as had been originally intended, but one LCM covering three out of the four policy areas considered, and one of those areas had changed considerably since it was last considered by the committee. The committee learned later that the department had circulated a draft executive paper on the proposals for consideration by the executive at its meeting on the 27th of October, and following feedback on the draft, the final paper tabled and ultimately approved did not include the provisions relating to biometric retention in relation to foreign convictions. On the 7th of November, the Department of Justice laid a further legislative consent memorandum for the Policing and Crime Bill, which superseded the memorandum laid on the 27th of October. The further legislative consent memorandum covered the three areas included in the 27th of October memorandum and an additional policy area, pardons for convictions of certain abolished offences. Now that I have outlined how we got to this point, I will cover each provision separately, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I will deal with the provisions relating to UK maritime enforcement powers last, as the committee spent a considerable amount of time on that area, and not without difficulty or frustration. But in relation to the UK cross-jurisdictional arrest powers, the Home Office is proposing an amendment to the Criminal Justice and Public Order Act 1994 to fill a long-term gap which prevents an officer in their own jurisdiction arresting a person without warrant on suspicion of having committed an offence in another UK jurisdiction. The provisions in the Policing and Crime Bill will show police officers in England, Wales, Scotland and Northern Ireland to arrest a person in their own jurisdiction for a serious offence committed in another jurisdiction. Consequential changes will also be made to the existing powers of entry and search, but only for the offences that are indictable. And it is noted that consequential amendments to current PACE codes of practice will also be required. At its meeting on the 22nd of September 2016, the Committee for Justice agreed that it was content with the proposal to extend the police powers across UK jurisdictions, provisions in the Policing and Crime Bill to Northern Ireland by way of the LCM. In relation to anonymity for victims of forced marriage, the Committee was fully supportive of this provision being extended to Northern Ireland. At present, a victim of forced marriage in Northern Ireland may only be granted anonymity at the discretion of the court. So in reality, anonymity is not automatic. The proposed amendment to the Policing and Crime Bill would provide automatic, lifelong anonymity to victims of forced marriage and would prohibit publication or broadcast of any information likely to result in the victim being identified, whether in traditional print, broadcast or social media. The prohibition can only be reversed if the victim applies to the court to remove it. Anyone found guilty of breaching it will be subject to the fine not exceeding level 5, which is £5,000 on summary conviction. The committee agrees that there is a significant value in making provision for the anonymity of victims of forced marriage in Northern Ireland at this time. The committee understands that it is a very rare crime in Northern Ireland, but it concurs with the Department's view that it is important that victims here are afforded the same level of protection as victims in England and Wales. At its meeting on the 15th September, the committee agreed to seek clarification of whether anonymity for a UK citizen who is a victim of forced marriage extends to other jurisdictions outside the UK. The Department responded, clarifying that the offence of breaching a prohibition on publication of the identity of a victim of forced marriage will apply on a UK-wide basis, but does not extend beyond the UK. In relation to social media, any domestic service providers established in England, Wales, Scotland or Northern Ireland will publish a prohibited matter in a European Economic Area state other than the UK may be liable to prosecution. At its meeting on the 22nd of September, the Committee for Justice considered all the information available to it and agreed that it was content with the proposal to extend the provision for lifelong anonymity of victims of forced marriage to Northern Ireland by way of the legislative consent motion. At the meeting on the 10th of November, the Committee for Justice considered for the first time new provisions that had been included in the legislative consent memorandum laid in the Assembly on the 7th of November, to provide for pardons for convictions relating to now abolished homosexual offences. Departmental officials attended the meeting to update members on the revised legislative consent memorandum laid on the 7th of November and the new provisions. Officials advised the committee that on the 7th of November the Minister received, through urgent procedure, executive agreement to seek agreement from the Assembly to extend the provisions to Northern Ireland. Late amendments to the Policing and Crime Bill tabled by Lords Committee at the Lords Committee stage would provide, in England and Wales, statutory pardons for persons with convictions, including military convictions under service law, for abolished homosexual offences involving consensual activity with persons over the current age of consent. These amendments build on existing provision in England and Wales in the Protection of Freedoms Act 2012, which introduced a disregard scheme for such offences. Subsequent amendments tabled by Lord Lexton would make provision for Northern Ireland by introducing the disregard powers in the Protection of Freedoms Act 2012, along with the new provisions which will provide statutory pardons for abolished homosexual offences. Officials informed the committee that inclusion of these provisions in the legislative consent memorandum would allow the UK Parliament to include Lord Lexton's amendments and thereby provide the same arrangements in Northern Ireland as proposed for England and Wales in relation to the pardoning of abolished homosexual offences. During discussions, Mr Roy Beggs expressed reservations about the pardoning of abolished homosexual offences, which were illegal at that time in the context of the age of consent issue. Ms Claire Bailey asked whether the pardon would be accompanied by an apology from Westminster or the Executive Office, and in response departmental officials advised that an apology did not form part of the provisions being put forward in the House of Lords. While the committee agreed at its meeting on the 10th of November that it was content with the proposal to extend the provisions for pardons for convictions for abolished homosexual offences to Northern Ireland, it also agreed to ask the Minister of Justice whether she is minded to undertake a review to identify the scale of other anomalies specific to Northern Ireland that may need to be addressed in relation to heterosexual offences. A response was received from the Minister indicating that she has asked officials to consider this matter, and the Minister's comments today have expanded on that, and I thank the Minister for giving this House the clarification around that. A very, very clear statement of content. So thank you very much, Minister, for that. I will now turn to the provisions in relation to maritime enforcement laws and powers. The Home Office wrote to the Department in April of this year seeking legislative consent for law enforcement officers in England and Wales to exercise maritime enforcement powers in Northern Ireland waters in hot pursuit situations. Following that, the Scottish Government requested that law enforcement officers in Scotland were provided with powers corresponding to those conferred on members of police forces in England and Wales and certain other law enforcement officers. This included powers of hot pursuit from Scottish waters into Northern Ireland territorial waters, which also required the legislative consent of this Assembly. The Department advised the Committee that, given the Scottish Government's request for powers corresponding to those conferred on members of police forces in England and Wales, officials consulted with the PSNI on whether a case could be made for equivalent maritime enforcement powers to be extended to Northern Ireland within the Bill. In response, according to the Department, the PSNI advised that it had limited maritime capabilities and there was no pressing need for additional powers to be made available to its officers at present. Based on the PSNI's view, the Department indicated that it was minded not to extend the maritime powers to Northern Ireland. However, officials highlighted that a legislative consent motion would still be required to provide legislative consent for law enforcement officers in England, Wales and Scotland to exercise their powers in Northern Ireland waters, but only in hot pursuit situations. The officials also advised the committee that discussions were ongoing between the Department and the Home Office with regard to the accountability arrangements for the hot pursuit powers in the Bill, which at the time of introduction were contrary to that which the previous Assembly provided legislative consent for in relation to the hot pursuit provisions in the Modern Slavery Act. The Modern Slavery Act memorandum provided consent for the Police Ombudsman for Northern Ireland to investigate any complaints made against officers from police forces in England and Wales in the exercise of hot pursuit powers in Northern Ireland waters. However, the Bill contained a clause which would have the effect of extending jurisdiction of the Independent Police Complaints Commission in England and Wales to hot pursuit powers in both the Modern Slavery Act and the Bill. Following the oral evidence session with departmental officials on the 15th of September, the committee agreed to request information from the Minister of Justice on accountability arrangements in relation to the Police Ombudsman. The Minister confirmed that her department had agreed an approach with the Home Office which makes provision for local accountability where hot pursuit maritime powers are exercised in Northern Ireland waters to ensure that officers are properly held to account and that the Police Ombudsman was content with the oversight arrangements. The committee also wrote to the Chief Constable asking why the PSNI held the view that maritime enforcement powers in relation to hot pursuit should not be extended to Northern Ireland. Assistant Chief Constable Todd stated in his response that while at the present time it was unlikely that the PSNI would have occasion to use hot pursuit powers in Northern Ireland waters, it was not its intent to in some way create a safe haven. The PSNI was of the view that to ensure consistency across UK waters, it would be in the national interest to extend the proposed enforcement powers to Northern Ireland by way of a legislative consent motion. The committee's concerns, however, did not centre around law enforcement officers from other UK jurisdictions being provided maritime enforcement powers in Northern Ireland waters in hot pursuit situations. Rather, the committee was considering whether the PSNI should get equivalent powers to go into other UK jurisdiction waters. Having considered the responses from both the Minister of Justice and the PSNI, the committee agreed to seek further information from the Minister of Justice on the accountability arrangements to the Policing Board in relation to incidents involving law enforcement officers from any of the UK legal jurisdictions exercising hot pursuit powers in Northern Ireland waters, and advised her that the committee was minded to recommend that maritime enforcement powers in relation to hot pursuit should be extended to Northern Ireland, but would consider the matter further upon receipt of the additional information requested. The committee also agreed to seek clarification from the Chief Constable on his position regarding extending the powers of hot pursuit to the PSNI, and the particular reasons why the PSNI did not seek or support maritime enforcement powers in relation to hot pursuit being extended to Northern Ireland in the first instance. The Minister of Justice responded on the 21st of September, providing information on the proposed accountability arrangements to the Policing Board in relation to law enforcement officers from any of the UK jurisdictions exercising maritime hot pursuit powers in Northern Ireland territorial waters, and indicated that she was not minded to include a provision for either the Chief Constable of the PSNI or other Chief Officers of GB forces to be required to report to the Policing Board on the exercise of hot pursuit powers. Assistant Chief Constable Todd confirmed in his response that he was content that the powers of hot pursuit should be extended to the PSNI. Assistant Chief Constable Todd also clarified that the original position attributed to the PSNI appeared to have been as a result of an informal conversation between staff who were trying to be helpful in progressing the matter, and the position was not fully considered at a senior level at that time. I feel that is absolutely astounding. Having considered the responses from both the Minister of Justice and the PSNI, members indicated at the committee meeting on the 29th of September that they still did not have the necessary clarification to reach a decision on the proposal to extend the maritime enforcement powers in hot pursuit circumstances. The committee therefore requested further information from the Minister on whether the PSNI ever had to stop a hot pursuit operation because it would have resulted in officers going beyond Northern Ireland territorial waters. What implications, if any, there would likely be for the PSNI in terms of additional resources, funding if maritime enforcement powers were provided, and the legislative changes required to provide the accountability powers to the Police Ombudsman, details of the amendment and how they would be taken forward. In relation to law enforcement officers from any of the other UK jurisdictions exercising maritime hot pursuit powers in Northern Ireland territorial waters, some members indicated that there needed to be an accountability mechanism to the Northern Ireland Policing Board in respect of such operations, and suggested that this could take the form of retrospective accountability by the Chief Constable. The Minister was therefore also asked to outline her proposals to address this issue. In her response, the Minister advised that engagement had now taken place at ACC level within the PSNI, and that the Chief Constable was also cited on the matter. The Minister reiterated that the PSNI would welcome reciprocal maritime powers, including powers to cover circumstances whereby PSNI officers might enter other UK territorial waters in hot pursuit circumstances. In such circumstances, the Department clarified that it had been agreed with the Home Office and the Office of the Police Ombudsman for the Police Ombudsman, that the Police Ombudsman would continue to have oversight of PSNI officers operating in England and Welsh waters. The Minister also advised that to date there had been no cases where the PSNI had to stop a hot pursuit operation because it would have resulted in officers going beyond Northern Ireland territorial waters. In respect of the likely resource funding implications arising from the PSNI having been given maritime enforcement powers in hot pursuit situations, the Department confirmed that the PSNI had purchased new boats in 2015 which were capable of going beyond the 12 miles required to leave Northern Ireland waters. Therefore, the only identifiable cost at this time would be minimal and related to participation training in any exercises arising as a result of the new powers. In addition to the legislative changes that would be required to provide accountability powers to the Police Ombudsman for Northern Ireland, the Minister informed members that amendments would need to be made to the Police Northern Ireland Acts 1998 and 2000 and some associated subordinate legislation. The Minister also advised that the amendments would be incorporated into the Policing and Crime Bill and would ensure that the Police Ombudsman retains proper powers of investigation in relation to all officers when exercising the powers of a constable in Northern Ireland waters, and PSNI officers when in other UK territorial waters. In the same response, the Minister also referred to an issue around accountability that had arisen in relation to Scottish officers. The Minister informed the committee that the Scottish Government was not in a position to agree to the proposed model of oversight for Scottish officers by the Police Ombudsman for Northern Ireland. However, the Department was working with the Home Office and Scottish Government to resolve that issue. The Minister suggested that to progress the legislative consent motion, the appropriate provision relating to the exercise of powers by Scottish officers in Northern Ireland waters should remain in the bill, but on the firm understanding that those provisions would only remain when all parties are agreed on appropriate accountability arrangements. At its meeting on the 6th of October, the Committee of Justice agreed that it was content with the proposed legislative consent motion on maritime enforcement powers, subject to the following: the addition of maritime enforcement powers in relation to hot pursuit being extended to the PSNI. Secondly, the Policing Board was content with the proposals for retrospective accountability by the Chief Constable to the Board. And thirdly, the provision for maritime enforcement powers in relation to hot pursuit by Scottish officers in Northern Ireland territorial waters should only remain if the Scottish Government agreed the proposed model of oversight by the Office of the Police Ombudsman for Northern Ireland. At the Department of Justice evidence session on the 10th of November, the officials advised members that following the committee's conditional agreement to the proposed LCM on maritime enforcement powers, departmental officials attended a meeting of the Policing Board on the 22nd of October and discussed the proposed oversight and accountability arrangements. The Department advised that whilst some board members were supportive, the Board was unable to reach an agreed position and sought further time to consider this matter. The Department also advised that it had not been possible to secure the agreement of the Scottish Government to oversight of Police Scotland officers when operating in Northern Ireland waters. The Department indicated that the issue was around Scottish officers being subject to greater scrutiny in the Northern Ireland waters. When asked whether the hot pursuit provisions could be extended to Northern Ireland, England and Wales only, departmental officials advised that it was the Home Office's view that any arrangements for maritime enforcement powers in hot pursuit situations should cover all jurisdictions and should be included in the same legislative vehicle. In the absence of agreement, and given the tight legislative timescales associated with the passage of the bill through Westminster, the Department removed the provisions for hot pursuit into Northern Ireland waters from the legislative consent memorandum. The Department confirmed, however, that it remains of the view that there is merit in seeking to resolve these issues and to reach a mutually acceptable agreement in slower time. Therefore, the draft motion included in the legislative consent memorandum tabled on the 7th of November does not cover hot pursuit powers. In relation to maritime enforcement powers, the draft motion seeks the extension of wider maritime enforcement powers that would give the PSNI powers to seek to prevent, detect, investigate and or prosecute offences committed on vessels in Northern Ireland waters. In practice, the PSNI would be able to stop, board, divert and detain a vessel, to search and obtain information and to arrest and seize evidence of any offence on vessels in Northern Ireland territorial waters. This, of course, is to be welcomed and was supported by the Justice Committee. Members, I apologise for the length of time I have taken to set out details of the scrutiny that the Justice Committee has taken in respect of this legislative consent memorandum and motion, but it is important, vitally important, to highlight the need to consider proposed LCMs in detail. After all, it is legislation, but also to illustrate the handling of it, and in particular the maritime enforcement hot pursuit element by the Department. I could refer to Hansard, Deputy Speaker. The committee expressed extreme disappointment and frustration at the series of failures by the Department in its handling of the issue of maritime enforcement powers in hot pursuit situations, which ultimately resulted in hot pursuit powers being removed completely from the LCM and the bill. Concerns included delayed engagement with the Policing Board when it was clear there were accountability issues, and the informal arrangements for engagement between the Department of Justice and the PSNI, it was on legislative matters. The department only went to the policing board on the 22nd of October. This bill had been first reading in February, but yet the department only seemed fit to go to the policing board at the request, if you like, of this Justice Committee on the 22nd of October. It alarms me also that there was a very loose and formal arrangement between the Department of Justice and the PSNI on these legislative matters, something of very great importance, and yet it seemed to be that the PSNI were being helpful when they didn't request or require or see the need for hot pursuit powers or reciprocal powers going the other way. It was obvious to the committee. It was obvious to the committee at the very first meeting that we would be requiring or asking of the department to have those same powers. If it's good enough for England, Scotland, Wales to come into our waters in hot pursuit, how would it not be the same then for PSNI officers going the other way? The department acknowledged that it could have done better and apologised that it had been distracted by trying to resolve the issue of oversight by the police ombudsman, and as a result had omitted to engage earlier with the policing board. The department also confirmed that formal arrangements had now been put in place for engagement at the proper level with the PSNI on legislative and other important matters. I think this is a lesson for everyone on the importance of proper scrutiny of LCMs by committees and appropriate attention to detail and provision of accurate and clear information on the relevant provisions by departments. In conclusion, the Committee of Justice agreed at its meeting on the 10th of November 2016 that it was content with the proposal to extend maritime enforcement powers to Northern Ireland by way of a legislative consent motion, subject to the Minister giving a commitment during this debate on the legislative consent motion that work will be progressed as quickly as possible by the Department of Justice to make provision for maritime enforcement powers in hot pursuit situations for the PSNI officers, and to identify an appropriate legislative vehicle to give effect to this at the earliest opportunity. The commitment outlined by the committee has now been given from the Minister, subject to the agreement of the Policing Board in relation to accountability, and reaching agreement with the Scottish Government on the oversight arrangements for Police Scotland officers when in Northern Ireland waters. Therefore, the Committee of Justice supports the Minister of Justice in seeking the Assembly's endorsement of the legislative consent motion. However, I do want to point out that the Committee is of the view that the PSNI getting hot pursuit powers should not be dependent on agreement with the Scottish Government. The Committee would like to see the PSNI getting hot pursuit powers regardless of Scotland's position, and would expect the Department's negotiations with the Home Office to take this into account, although it is a matter for the Department of Justice and indeed the Home Office in this regard. Can I just add in conclusion, Mr Deputy Speaker, that this has not been an acceptable way and process of doing business between the Department and the Justice Committee in regards to LCMs. I think this has been a litany of errors right throughout this process since we first got our first briefing. It is not good enough to be going to the policing board in October when the bill was laid in the first reading in the Westminster legislature was in February. It is not good enough that the Justice Committee has to remind the Department of the accountability structures within Northern Ireland, and to ask then for permission and for consent of the policing board, and also then the arrangements with the police ombudsman. It has not been acceptable that we've had to extract all of this out of the department and the officials within the department throughout this whole process, and it left it very tight in time for us to get it here before this House today. I have seen many messes in my time as an MLA. I was on the Ethics Committee when I had to deal with the energy branch. Horrendous. I've been in PAC when things have went wrong in departments, and I must say Deputy Speaker, and to the Minister of Justice that this is up here. This ranks right up here in such a mess with a litany of errors. I don't want to lose my temper. I will leave it at that. But I expect much more from the Department of Justice when it comes to engagement with the Justice Committee and with the organisations who are stakeholders in any legislative process, whether that be the Policing Board, whether that be the Police Ombudsman, or any other theatre of justice when it comes to legislation coming before this House and the Department of Justice. And I hope, Deputy Speaker, lessons have been learnt in this case. I will leave it there. Thank you very much.
I call Doug Beattie.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I stand to support this LCM in its entirety, as outlined by the Justice Minister. I do so personally, and I do so on behalf of my party. I'm not going to reiterate what the Justice Minister, the Chair of the Justice Committee has said, because he's gone into it in quite some detail, and I think he really does need to go into that detail, because since we started dealing with this in June, it's been incredibly frustrating, and it certainly could have been done differently. And certainly if we look at the maritime enforcement powers and the hot pursuit issues, I've got to say we turned up on a weekly basis exasperated by the lack of progress in regards to that. But I welcome that the Justice Minister has said that she will pursue this at a later stage. And hopefully we'll be able to get around that. I don't want to go through the different component parts of this LCM, but as far as the anonymity for the victims of forced marriage, I was slightly disappointed that this could not have gone further, because as it stands now, that if you're a UK citizen, it's a chargeable offence if you mention the name of somebody who's a victim of forced marriage. But if you leave the country and you go and use a server in another country, such as Pakistan or somewhere like that, you could quite openly use the name and then return to the United Kingdom and there will be no offence committed. So it would have been nice to be able to have seen that extended further. But I'm still thankful that we have this as it stands now. It would be right in saying that the Justice Committee has had time to scrutinise this LCM in detail, and it's been important to do so. When we move on to the fourth component part of this LCM, and I don't want to focus on this too much and change the whole debate that we're having, but it would be fair in saying that the pardon for convictions of certain abolished offences did come late to the committee. And because it came late to the committee, it is fair to say that it was possibly rushed, and I can concede with that. But I do see it as a legislative process, and I do see these things as being viewed on a case-by-case basis. Those shot at dawn were pardoned 90 years after. That was a good pardon. Alan Turing was pardoned in 2013. I think that was right. And the decriminalisation of homosexual acts in Northern Ireland came into force 34 years ago. I think what this LCM does, it puts right the consequences of a bad law. And therefore, I do believe that the Justice Committee, with the Chair, has scrutinised this LCM at the right level, and I will certainly be supporting it. Thank you.
Éireann Saoire Michaela Boyle. I call Michaela Boyle.
Gormaugat, Cancolia. I want to thank the Chair for the level of detail that he has given to the House today on this LCM. And on behalf of the Sinn Féin members on the Justice Committee, and indeed my party, I want to put on record and register our concerns over the way in which the Department handled the process, particularly on the maritime pursuit powers within this LCM. We believe that the Department officials must take a methodical approach in the handling of these matters. They must respect other accountability mechanisms, specifically the Policing Board. The full transfer of policing and justice powers must work effectively and efficiently. And we do welcome the full sweep of policing and justice powers here. However, Cancolia, on the same token, all of the accountability mechanisms must work together to have open and transparent reporting on such matters. And indeed, at the committee, at the meeting of the committee of the 10th of November, when department officials were briefing, I just want to echo a valid point that the Chair, Paul Frew, raised with officials. It was the case that when a piece of legislation goes before the PSNI, it must be dealt with at the highest level, the highest senior level, and that the person dealing with that has the skills and expertise to form opinion if it is good or a bad piece of legislation from a policing point of view. And I want to echo the Chair's sentiment on that. This is critical for the process of legislation. The appropriate levels of communication is key in many aspects of accountability. And as the Chair stated, I think we do need, lessons need to be learned from what has happened here. This, I mean, as the Chair said, at the behest of the committee, this probably wouldn't have pursued to where it was. And this is what a scrutiny committee is all about, ensuring accountability and ensuring that that accountability is upheld. However, we did appreciate the department admitting it could have done better. The LCM before us today seeks a provision on four areas: the maritime enforcement powers, which excluding hot pursuit for reasons that the Chair outlined, the cross-jurisdiction arrest powers, and pardons for convictions of abolished gay and bisexual offences. And I want to speak just briefly on the latter of the LCM. Indeed, that should never have been made an offence in the first place. This was a cruel and unjust homophobic law, a dinosaur law. A lot of people have been harmed as a result of this law, and no one should be discriminated against or be found guilty or of being a criminal for falling in love. The Minister's proposals are a step in the right direction, and we welcome them. The Minister's approach to abolish this law has to be welcomed here in the House today. We support the motion, and we had asked others to do so, and we won't be supporting the amendment. Gormagat.
Eireann Sir Alex Atwood. I call Alex Atwood.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and could I apologise to the Chair of the Committee and to Mr. Alistair. I was called away to an unscheduled meeting, so I missed both their contributions, but I did hear the contribution of the Minister prior to question time. So I apologise if there is ground being covered that was addressed by others. The issue, from what I've heard, and rightly so, questions have been raised about the management of this, both in the PSNI and on the Department of Justice side. In my view, Mr. Deputy Speaker, what may be revealed by how the department managed this is a failure of understanding at a department level of the thresholds and requirements of pattern and accountability for police actions in the North. And what worries me is whatever the detail about how this was managed at a department level in response to the probing of the committee, is there a wider issue about understanding at a departmental level about the requirements for accountability when it comes to policing in Northern Ireland? And if there is a systemic problem, I'd be more alarmed than the management problem that was clearly identified and how this was approached by the department. So if it's a management problem, you can put in processes to tick boxes to make sure that it's managed properly. But if there's a cultural problem, that there was a failure to understand that the actions of anybody with police powers in Northern Ireland, besides those of the PSNI, should be accountable to the policing board, then that's a much deeper issue. The reason why I'm concerned about the wider, deeper issue that may or may not be advertised by what happened in this case is that it's not so long ago, Mr. Deputy Speaker, when a lot of time and effort was engaged in trying to rectify the false approach being adopted by the Home Office and by some within the Department of Justice when it came to accountability for the National Crime Agency. It was only February of 2014 when that matter was corrected in terms of the right thresholds of accountability when it came to conduct of the NCA. And yet, a short time later, the Department of Justice, it appears, were making proposals that didn't give due authority and recognition to the role of the policing board when it came to the conduct of police officers in Northern Ireland. So I'd like the Minister to respond to that issue in terms of, is there any failure of understanding at the departmental level that when a police officer or not a person with police powers is operating in Northern Ireland, be it the PSNI or the NCA or police officers from another police service in Britain, when they're operating here, there must never be any doubt about accountability to the policing board, because a doubt was created in this regard in this particular LCM. And I think that's fundamental. And it needs to be fundamental going forward, because in the view of the SDLP, accountability around policing has been degraded over a period of time. And we don't need to see any more degradation when it comes to the authority of the policing board and accountability for police actions in Northern Ireland. And I'd like the Minister to give that reassurance to ensure that when it comes to a departmental level, there's no lack of understanding as to the thresholds that were established and should be jealously guarded. Otherwise, we would be in a much more severe place. And it may be, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that this particular instance, which may not arise on many occasions, about the accountability of police officers outside Northern Ireland for their activities in relation to here, it mightn't arise very much, but once bitten, twice shy, and let's ensure that there's no repetition of the failure of management on one hand, and hopefully on a much worse level, the failure of recognition about how these things should be conducted when it comes to these matters. I also want to be fair to the Chair and to the Vice-Chair and to the Committee. The standards of the last Justice Committee, this is a personal view, and I was only on the Justice Committee for a very short period of months, but the Justice Committee in the last mandate, in my view, in my experience and from what other people said, actually, when it came to the conduct of committees, fulfilled higher levels of thresholds when it came to calling to account ministers and public policy generally. And that was a recognition of the membership and the chair and vice chair of the last committee. And I have to say, it's my experience in the short life of this committee that those thresholds and standards are again being upheld. And that's good for the life of the Assembly and good for the life of the Justice Committee. But just as the committee has been attentive and vigilant, and I also have to acknowledge the work of the committee staff and the clerk in particular in all of this, just as it's been vigilant and attentive, it does tell the Assembly to be very vigilant when it comes to LCMs, because we had an experience, unfortunately, in this chamber this morning, Mr. Deputy Speaker, where an LCM was pushed through, the consequences of which I don't believe the Assembly fully understands, about how third-level education, higher education, has been fundamentally reconfigured, and therefore we should be very mindful about LCMs and the conduct of the Justice Committee and the work of the Chair in particular in this matter, I think, is worthy of further consideration. The third point is that there is an interesting concept now being created, and I'm not going to challenge the words of this, but police officers from other jurisdictions in Britain who might come to Northern Ireland in terms of their activities around maritime will now retrospectively account to the policing board. Well, they might want to retrospectively explain, but I don't know retrospectively account is the right word, because under Patton, under the police legislation, under the NCA, there are very rigorous requirements laid down in terms of what accountability looks like. And retrospective accountability for what a police officer might have done in Northern Ireland is different, in my view, from the thresholds that apply now in respect of the NCA and in respect of the PSNI to the policing board. I've put down a marker that if we think there's going to be the same retrospectively accountability, that retrospective accountability will look identical to other examples of accountability police board, we might be disappointed. The SDLP support, however, the LCM across the range of its content, including that which has arisen most recently in respect of pardons for abolished offences. We should take any opportunity in this Assembly to right wrongs. That's what this proposal does in terms of pardons for abolished offences, and for that reason we will be opposing Mr Alistair's amendment.
Éireann Saoire Trevor Lunn. I call Trevor Lunn.
Thank you very much, Mr Deputy Speaker. We also will support the LCM in its entirety. Like others, I don't want to repeat a whole lot of what's been said before, but the Minister has laid out the terms of the LCM quite adequately. Mr Frew has certainly done justice to the concerns that the committee had around the process and the hoops we had to go to. Every committee meeting seemed to be another twist and turn, and I will agree with the Minister to the extent that the Department didn't cover itself with glory. In this episode, to my mind, neither did the PSNI, who couldn't seem to make up their mind if they wanted hot pursuit or not, even though they've got two lovely new boats that will go more than 12 miles. And the policing board also couldn't seem to make up its mind. They couldn't come to an agreement about the way forward. So while I think the Department, as I say, hadn't been its best day, but they weren't helped by these other organisations. As regards the hot pursuit issue, well, words fail me, Mr Deputy Speaker. I just wonder what happened to the EU and United Kingdom and all this. I mean, the fact that we have a 12-mile limit in Northern Ireland, and so has England, so has Scotland, and so has Wales, and presumably so has the Isle of Man, I don't really know, but maybe they have. Do you? Well, there you are. There's another one. You're going to have to carry a computer to decide whose water they're in. And all this to do with trying to apprehend criminals and chasing boats around the Irish Sea, which is about this, not much bigger than the big pond. To me, it's just ridiculous that we're actually having to go through all this just to try and establish whose jurisdiction it is within the United Kingdom, and who should be accountable to who, and who can enter whose territorial waters. I better not go on about that. We're not talking about the Baltic or the Red Sea here, or that wee bit of water between Cuba and America. Yes, certainly.
Thank you very much indeed for giving way. I think the unfortunate matter of this is, of course, that if we actually still had a Royal Navy left, we could actually let them do the hot pursuit as it was traditional.
Well, presumably, if Mr. Egan had his way, we could use submarines to do a bit of hot pursuit, and then they wouldn't even know they were there. But, you know, this is over the top, frankly. But anyway, we are where we are. And the other bit of the LCM to do with the maritime enforcement powers that are now being extended in terms of Northern Ireland, PSNI, operating in their own territorial waters. That's a good thing. I mean, prior to this Act, this bill, this LCM, you know, they had to try and establish where they're talking about. It was a boat that they were suspicious of operating in terms of human trafficking or slavery, or what's the other word? Forced labour, servitude. In other words, if they thought it was carrying drugs, they couldn't do anything about it. And if they thought the boat was stolen, presumably they couldn't do anything about it. So now at least that has been tidied up. That's a good thing. And maybe it's a good start for the PSNI that they can now rigorously enforce our law in our own territorial waters. So I think that's good. The cross-jurisdictional arrest part, I think, is also a very good piece of tidying up that's probably long overdue. I notice it only applies in terms of, well, effectively very serious offences that carry at least perhaps the potential for a 10-year sentence. That's pretty severe. But it does mean that the police can do the natural thing. If they see somebody who's wanted, with or without a warrant, that they can arrest them for a fixed period while the necessary paperwork comes through, for the want of a better description. The last section of this, the pardon for homosexual offences, I wouldn't know what to say about this, but I'll probably say something anyway. I just hope Mr. Alistair never has a relative who is LGBT, because I wonder what he would say to him or her, frankly. You talked about process. Now, I listen to Mr. Alistair with considerable respect because he has a very good legal brain. And in terms of process, although he let himself down eventually, but he did point out some defects in the way this has been dealt with. It's not quite normal. Should be consultation, all the rest of it. But it doesn't make it any less desirable that we do something about a law that Mrs. Boyle said should never have been passed in the first place. This is the putting something right that was never right to start with. And I frankly think that Mr. Alistair, as he went on, betrayed his own prejudice and his own feelings several times. So I won't detail what he said. It's on Hansard. But it's pretty obvious that even in the way he says LGBT, as if he's got a bad taste in his mouth, is disgraceful. And the way he answered questions or refused to answer questions from various members. Mr. Alistair's problem in this is he doesn't like, well, in a minute, he doesn't like homosexuality. He finds it distasteful. He said so so many times. So now it's on the record now. He said it out here in the open chamber, and it's there for posterity to decide what people in the future will think about it. I'll give way to him.
The member referred to me refusing to answer questions. I think I gave way to any and every member who asked me to give way, as is my wont. So what did I fail to deal with?
You didn't answer Claire Hannah's question for a start, but you know you didn't. And I would suggest to people like Mr. Alistair that they should reflect on their views on this issue. And in a different side of the issue, members will be aware that I made a change of mind in terms of homosexuality and same-sex marriage. I would suggest to Mr. Alistair that he should engage with the LGBT community and find out what their feelings are about this and about the sort of attitude that he portrays. And he might also have a word with the British Psychological Society, who had such an effect on me in the circumstances. But I'm putting it on the record, I think his amendment is disgraceful. I sincerely hope that he can't get a second teller, because if I was forced to vote, it would be a sad reflection in this House. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
I call Paula Bradshaw.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I rise to welcome the opportunity to speak on this legislative consent motion today, and I thank the Justice Minister for bringing it before the Assembly today. As other people have spoken about the various elements of it, but like my colleague Trevor Lunn, at the start here, I want to focus in on the convictions of certain abolished offences for homosexuals. And I would like to remind members of Jim Alistair's behaviour in 2013 when he signed an amendment to ban Mary Stopes clinics here in the Criminal Justice Bill 2013 without consultation. A lot of what he said today hinged on the fact that he said that this was being brought forward without consultation. I call that hypocrisy. The Bible calls hypocrisy a sin. And if he wants to, I'll go through some of the verses in the Bible that refer to that. But I would just like to put that on record that I was really disgusted by the tone and the content of Mr. Alistair's remarks today. Because what he's talking about is nearly 76,000 individuals. And I'm going to focus in on Alan Turing, who, as some of you may have heard, I mentioned at the start. What happened to him was absolutely deplorable. He gave years of his life to national service, was pivotal in breaking the wartime Enigma codes, and as a result made significant contributions to the Allied forces winning the World War II. And despite this, his dedication and contribution to his country were repaid by chemical castration, and he sadly committed suicide at the age of 41. So, Mr. Deputy Speaker, had Alan Turing been heterosexual, there would have been an outcry in this chamber and across the UK at the shocking manner in which someone so pivotal to the World War II effort, how he was treated. But he was guilty of just one crime, being a homosexual and embracing it in a consensual relationship. Accordingly, it is good and right that he has now been pardoned by the Queen in 2013, but we must remember that his case is well known for the disrespectful way in which this war hero was treated. Although he popularised the issue, as I say, 75,895 other individuals who underwent the mental trauma of being vilified for who they were, 75,895 who underwent the shame of a conviction for something that should never have been deemed illegal. I acknowledge that a number of people contributing to today's motion and the people who will be affected by it is small compared to numbers in England and Wales. However, the gesture in and of itself from this chamber today will be far-reaching because it will be a public positive gesture of goodwill and compassion for the LGBT community. A community that often feels ostracised and separate from Northern Ireland's society. In addition, we are faced with an irony here today in that the conviction is overturned as if it's perceived the crime had never taken place. However, marriage equality remains a distant reality. This means that privately heterosexuals can engage in a consensual and loving relationship, yet this relationship continues not to be recognised by the state as it would be with a heterosexual couple as in marriage. And I stress by the state and not by the church. I hope that today's motion will go some way to recognising that in this chamber and that one day we will see marriage equality. So to conclude, Mr Deputy Speaker, I support the LCM, I do not support the amendment, and I hope the pardons will go some way towards making amends and that we could spark a more positive relationship between this chamber and the LGBT community. Thank you.
I call Claire Bailey.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. And I rise to support this LCM also in its entirety, but would just like to mention that as part of, as a member of the Justice Committee, it has been fascinating to watch the level of scrutiny, the hard work and the sheer determination and perseverance by the members of the committee and the level of scrutiny that they have put into this. It certainly set the bar very high for the years to come. So it's been a huge learning curve for me, so well done and thank you for being part of that. But I think the majority of the work has been highlighted. We've talked about the maritime powers and I won't go through everything again except to say that the Green Party don't feel that we can object to anything in that, but we can't support the amendment to this LCM. The last piece of this LCM we welcome. We welcome the pardons for convictions of now abolished offences, specifically the statutory pardons for persons with convictions of now abolished offences under what was historic anti-gay legislation. We welcome this. But I also expect that this would be the first time this House has ever effected positive, progressive change through a vote on a matter of equality related to sexual orientation. Our social attitude toward gay people has still a long way to go. Transphobic and homophobic hate crimes are still largely underreported, if reported at all. We still have people elected to public office who advocate for the recriminalisation of LGBT people and others who believe that it's possible to cure being gay. Many people in the past who've had to carry these convictions with them have ended up taking their own lives. Who knows what and who they might have went on to be? Perhaps doctors, lawyers, or members of this House as parliamentarians. Others who've carried with them the shame for the rest of their lives without being able to speak to family members or loved ones about it. And some who may be alive today who are classed as criminals for now non-existent crimes. I hope that all members of this House can support the extension of this LCM in its entirety and help send out a very clear message to our LGBT community that they are not criminals any more than the rest of us. For these reasons, the Green Party will not be supporting the amendment which seeks to exclude the posthumous pardons altogether and leave LGBT equality lagging behind the rest of the UK yet again. I hope the extension of this LCM can bring a focus on equality legislation in general to this House over this mandate. If the programme for government seeks a more equal society, where we care for others and where we help those in need, where we are a confident, welcoming, outward-looking society, then we must make moves on equality for all people. This must include the equal treatment of people on the basis of their sexual orientation and gender identity. This is a cornerstone principle of a modern democracy. Speaker, we support the LCM. Thank you.
I call Stephen Agnew.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Often when we talk about privilege in our society, we mean in terms of wealth. And in that regard, I was not born with a silver spoon in my mouth, but I recognise that I had many other privileges that I was born with rather than earned. I'm white, I'm able-bodied, I'm a cisgendered straight male, and with that comes many privileges for which I have been fortunate to benefit from. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I want to be part of a generous majority in that regard. I want, as someone of privilege, to extend as much as possible the benefits I have to others. And as somebody who grew up in a society, and certainly in the school playground, where the term gay and other derogatory terms to allude to sexuality were used as terms of abuse, I would like to apologise on behalf of myself only, because I don't have the status to do so on behalf of the state or others, but I would like to apologise if I used any of that language, any of those derogatory terms as a child in ignorance. I think this should be and is a proud day for this Assembly. I think this is, in fact, is a proud day for Northern Ireland. As my colleague Claire Bailey pointed out, this will be the first, assuming it has passed, the first piece of legislation to come to this House to promote and advance the rights of the LGBT community that will be passed in Northern Ireland. Civil partnerships came into being in Northern Ireland when we were under direct rule, and homosexuality was only decriminalised through action through the courts. And I welcome the fact that we stand on the verge of making a democratic decision to support and enhance the rights of our LGBT community. So I don't accept when Mr. Alistair used terms such as rushing enthusiastically for LGBT rights or to jump on the bandwagon. I think that's the last thing we could say this Assembly's done, although I would welcome it if we had. I don't think we can say that. But today, I think, is an important first step. I don't accept that today we validate homosexuality. It is valid. We do not have the power. We do not have the right to do that. It is normal sexual practice by virtually every definition of the word normal. I welcome the large degree of consensus there is today, but let's do not overstate our power. We do not validate homosexuality. We are not so arrogant. It is normal. It is valid. I think there is an important distinction to be made between the criminalisation of homosexuality and other laws that have become obsolete. I think in cases of clear discrimination, whether it be against, in this case, the LGBT community, whether it be the issue of slavery, or even if we go back, whether or not it be the burning of so-called witches, I think there is shame in our past. I think we should recognise it as a state and as legislators, and I think where possible we should seek to make reparations and to put it right. As I say, Mr. Deputy Speaker, today we take the first step as acting as a generous majority towards our LGBT community. It's a small step, it's the first step, and others must follow.
I call Jim Allister to wind on the amendment.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I don't for one moment question the sincerity of those who have spoken against my amendment. They have done so honestly and with integrity, and in a way I respect their contributions more than those who chose to have nothing to say about this subject. And I'll return to that in a moment. But just to pick up on Mr. Agnew's, one of his latter points, that, you know, there have been many things wrong in the past. The point I was making is, that may be right, but why is it that we're being selective in the pardoning process? Why is it we're choosing only those within the realm of sexual crimes who were homosexual in respect of obsolete offences that they committed? Why is it indeed in the wider criminal calendar, and he referred to witches? We had the Ivan McGee witches. There's been no pardon for them, so to speak. Why are we being so selective in deciding, we are going to push aside all the due process, we're going to rush forward with this single proposition relating to gay pardons, and everything else doesn't matter? Because that's the message that this House is sending out. There are multiple obsolete offences in every sphere of the criminal law, but only one recommends itself to this House for retrospective pardon. That's the point I'm making. The selectivity of that is wrong. The discrimination of that is wrong. And I illustrated that in relation to many heterosexual offences now in respect of matters that have become obsolete. Yes, certainly.
Come back to my point previously. He says about heterosexual offences, but they weren't by virtue of heterosexuality. This was discrimination against the whole homosexual community, and therein lies the difference. There is no law that has been repealed that discriminates against the whole heterosexual community in this way.
With respect, he's wrong. The member is wrong. The offences that I referred to were sex offences. Unlawful carnal knowledge with a 16-year-old. A significant criminal offence, now obsolete, but committed by heterosexuals. Buggery, committed by a homosexual, to be chosen out specially for pardon. Why? Because, as I suggested, the fashionable fad of wanting to be on that bandwagon. And this House betrays its true intent by the fact it has glossed over and rushed past all those other offences in order to get to the point of offering these pardons. And that is the point about the principle of it being wrong to foolishly think that we can rewrite the law retrospectively, that we, the legislators of 2016, should take upon ourselves the burden of being the legislators of the 1950s or whenever. We have enough to do looking after 2016. And yet that is the purpose of this added amendment. I said I respected those who disagreed with me, and I understand entirely the logic of their position. And I indicated I had more respect for them than those who've kept silent in this debate, because we haven't had a DUP speech in this debate. We had a speech by the chairman of the committee, but he did not at any point, as is normal, speak on behalf of his party. Why? because his party doesn't want to have anything on the record about this matter. That's why the party of Save Ulster from Sodomy doesn't want to have it on the record that they said anything about this matter, and that's why they're so anxious. There should be no vote in this House on this matter because of their own embarrassment, because of the fact they have those in their ranks who carried the placards, Save Ulster from Sodomy, and today know that the action that this House is taking is validating that very thing by saying that it was wrong for that to have been an offence. That's the inescapable import of the retrospective pardon. It's this collective societal contrition for the fact that that was ever an offence. And that, of course, embarrasses the party of that is the DUP, because they were so lined up with that particular campaign. And I'm disappointed that the instructions to their members are a three-line whip against this amendment. Of course, they're hoping it won't come to a vote. And they've been totally silent on this issue. This is the party which told us properly during the Ashers case what a shameful assault it was on freedom of conscience. And yet, when it comes to this issue, their members are not allowed to have a conscience, even though I know there are those on those benches who do not agree, they say, with this retrospective pardon. But they're not allowed a conscience on it. And I must say to the Ulster Unionists that I've often heard Mike Nesbitt boast of the fact that his is a party that takes pride in having free votes on issues of conscience. But not today. Mr. Nesbitt too has members who are unhappy about this matter. So where is the freedom of conscience? Yes, certainly. Where is the freedom of conscience on that side of the House on this issue? Why is it being suppressed? Yes, certainly.
I think it's frankly close to outrageous of the member to suggest there has been any suppression of opinion within the Ulster Unionist Party. We debated this matter at length this morning, and we are treating it not as a moral issue, but as a legal one. End of.
Not end of, because what that means is there's a party policy to vote against this amendment. And of course, both the Ulster Unionists and the DUP are hoping that there'll be no vote. They don't want, some of them, the embarrassment of having to go through the no lobby on this amendment in favour of this retrospective gay pardon. So they're hoping that Alistair might shout out for his motion, but no one else will. That even if he gets a division, there'll be no teller. And then we can go around the country and pretend there was no vote. Oh, we didn't vote for that. That is the stratagem that is being deployed, and particularly by the party that made it a central plank of saving Ulster from sodomy. Now going to validate that very thing. And as I said in my opening remarks, within its ranks, many people who take a strong religious view, we're told, who are ruling elders in a church which still proclaims homosexuality as a sin, which still believes buggery is wrong. And yet today, those elders, like Mr. Storey, Lord Morrow, Mr. Tom Buchanan, will sit on their hands. And if it comes to put the party before principle, now, Mr. Buchanan, just a couple of years ago, addressing school children, said
quoted in the local Ulster Herald as saying, homosexuality isn't right, it's an abomination. Which Mr. Buchanan's here today? Where's he hiding? Where's Mr. Storey hiding? Where's Lord Morrow hiding? And others who sat in pews yesterday in a church that still holds that homosexuality is a sin. That's the real challenge for those people. Are they going today to walk in their first ways, like Jehoshaphat, if you like? Are they going to follow the fashionable crowd? Are they going to take the hard road or the easy road? Are they going to do what's right or what's wrong? Very soon we'll know, Mr. Speaker.
I call on the Minister of Justice, to Clare Sugden, to wind on the motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I want to thank members for their contribution to this legislative consent motion. Specifically, I wish to put on record my sincere thanks to the Justice Committee for its report and the Executive Committee for its consideration of the issues at hand. I entirely take on board the criticisms of the Justice Committee of my department in respect of the accountability around this particular legislative consent motion. I also want to put on record that I fully respect the role of the committee. I appreciate their scrutiny of this legislative vehicle and more generally of the department. I'm also fully respectful of the role of the policing board and the police ombudsman. So yes, my department could have performed better in this respect, and for that I apologise. And we will perform better and be fully cognizant of the accountability mechanisms that exist in and around my department. In particular, I want to assure members that I am entirely mindful of the role of the policing board. And moving forward, my department is in no doubt of the role of the policing board either. I'm pleased, Mr. Speaker, generally of the support that has been shown around this chamber in respect of the four elements of this legislative consent motion, and I believe that it is sensible that these provisions be carried forward in the Westminster Bill. I will refer to the amendment tabled by Mr. Alistair in his intent to do so, and he had outlined three reasons for putting forward his amendment. The first of that was process. And I suppose Mr. Alistair accused me of not, you know, consulting around this particular area. But I think what these late amendments to the Policing and Crime Bill in Westminster has shown is that we need to take these opportunities where possible, Mr. Speaker. And indeed, we did consult around the process, and I want to put on record my sincere thanks to Mr. Alistair for his contribution to this particular debate, because if anything, it has made me more mindful of seizing this particular type of opportunity and what we need to do, and that's righting the wrongs of this of the past. Again, he refers to the principle around this, should we be rewriting the statute book, as he put it, what should have been. Are we arrogant? No, Mr. Speaker, I don't think we are. I think that this is a case that this was always a wrong piece of legislation, and there is an opportunity through this legislative consent motion that we can right the wrong of the past, and I want to congratulate all those members who will support us in doing so, because as Mr. Agnew has alluded to, this is a first step. And it's a first step, but I must stand here very, very deeply proud of as Justice Minister of Northern Ireland that we will support in this particular area. Discrimination, and again I want to thank Mr. Alistair for bringing this to my attention, because at the outset when it was revealed that we would move to table this LCM to the House, and in particular this particular part of the LCM, Mr. Alistair had raised concerns around Northern Ireland's particular difficulties around the Section 75 areas, and indeed we listened and we took those on board, and we are quite happy to proceed with this in terms of that age of 17. And you know, I think only for Mr. Alistair's intervention that we are able to proceed in that. So I want to thank Mr. Alistair for enabling this legislative consent motion to go through in the way that it is going to go through, because it has strengthened what we can do moving forward. So thank you, Mr. Alistair, for that. Mr. Speaker, I believe on this occasion that it is appropriate that these amendments will be made in the Westminster Bill. And I ask the House again that they will support the passing of this motion, and I thank all those who will do so. Thank you.
Members, the question is that the amendment standing on the marshal list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Aye.
Aye.
Clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. Order, order. Members resume their seats. The question is that the amendment standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Do we have tellers? Thank you. Members, I am satisfied that Standing Order 27.4 provides that within a reasonable time, neither side has nominated two tellers. The question shall not be carried. The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
The ayes have it. The ayes have it.